by this morning. Well, take a minute, hop over on this beautiful day, walk over, shake somebody's hand, tell them the Lord looks good on them. Are we ready to worship the Lord this morning? You guys stand with me, please. Come across this song. These lyrics just touch my heart, so I want to share it with you. It says, a restless generation. We're turning over every stone, hoping to find salvation. In a world that's left us cold, can we get back to the altar? Back to the arms of our first love. There's only one way to the Father, and He's calling out to us. To the captive, it looks like freedom. To the orphan, it feels like home. To the skeptic, it may sound crazy to believe in a God who loves. In a world where our hearts are breaking and we're lost in the mess we've made. Like a blinding light in the dead of night, it's the gospel that makes a way. Amen. It's the cure for our condition. It's the good news for us all. It's greater than religion. It's the power of the cross. The gospel is the power of the cross. It is the only cure we have right now. In the mess that we've made, that just jumped out at me. The mess that we've made, He is the cure. He is the only way. Lord, we invite You into this place. Holy Spirit, come. I say it every week, but Lord, I don't want to be here without You. Amen. I love these people, but I want You, Lord. Come be with us, guide us, and direct us. Have Your way in this place. We give it to You now. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. He is the King of Kings and He is the Lord of Lords, and His name is Jesus Christ. Amen.
More than anything, and Lord, as pray, Father, Lord, help us to realize in a more deep way how much we really do need you, God. Because as we're hungry and thirsting after you, Lord, you said you'll fill us. You'll fill us up with everything that you have. Lord, we just thank you for your fullness. We thank you, God, for what you're going to do in my life and each and every life in here. I need you more, oh, more than yesterday. I need you more than words can say. I need you more than ever before. I need you. I need you more than yesterday. I need you more than words can say. I need you more than ever before. I need you. There's a fire that can't be quenched, and a love for you as strong as death. And hear us, Lord, hear the longing of our hearts is to be where you are and not above. We feel you near. Your presence all around us, Lord. Oh, Lord, we want to see your face. So take us away. Spirit and the bride, oh, we cry out to you. Oh, we cry out to you. Come quick.
Day, oh, when we will see your face, oh, we Welcome, Holy Spirit. We are in your presence. Fill us with your power. Live inside of me. Welcome, Holy your power and live inside of me. Welcome, Holy Spirit, and welcome, Holy Spirit. We are in your presence and fill us with your power. Live inside of me.
Just real soft like he was a few moments ago. Oh, thank you, Lord.
Spirit and the bride, oh, we cry out to you. Oh, we cry out to you. Come quickly.
Breathe on us this morning. Just want to take just a moment while he's going through that real slow and soft. Just picture your Heavenly Father right now. How are you picturing? With your arms stretched open, reaching out towards you. And as you're doing that, just take some deep breaths. Just breathe in. Just imagine you're breathing in this presence. Breathing in his blessing. Breathing in his grace. Breathing in his mercy. Breathing in his touch. Breathing in his spirit. Holy Spirit, breathe. When you exhale any negative thought, any doubt, anything standing in your way, any thought that is not Jesus Christ right now, breathe it out. Don't worry about what's going on after church. Don't worry about getting ready for your get-together tomorrow. Just breathe in Christ this morning and breathe out anything that's not. Holy Spirit, breathe on us. Holy Spirit, have your way in this place. Lord, come. Breathe on us. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for your presence. Thank you, Lord. Oh, we give you grace. We give you praise. We give you honor, Lord. Oh, we love you and we thank you. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Amen. All right. You may be seated. Have a couple of prayer request here, and we'll get ready for the offering. We want to lift up Penny Carrick. She got pretty sick starting Wednesday night or Thursday and still got a hold of her. And there's a young boy. I think he's part of our daycare. He's 3 years old. His name's Nash Ragsdale. He's in St. Jude's today, right, you said, Mike, or headed there. But he's struggling with acute lymphoblastic leukemia. 3 years old, but let's just lift him up in prayer. In junior league, he was with us last week. He's not here today. He's having a real bunch of problems with his feet, and it's shooting up into his back. But Lord, we just thank you right now. We lift these up to you, Father. We plead your blood. Lord, I pray that you breathe into these situations, breathe life, breathe healing, and breathe wholeness. Lord, we just love you and we honor you. Lord, this offering this morning, we give it to you. We give it to you cheerfully, Father. We love you and we honor you and we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
He's taking Curtis says it's mine. Good morning. School is out. Summer is here. All the teachers say, yeah. Right, Lisa? Oh, I see that hand, sister. And all the kids say, okay. I think teachers are a little more excited than teachers. And all the parents say, oh, no. This is going to be a long summer. Well, I'll tell you what. We'll take a week for you. Not tomorrow, but a week from tomorrow is Vacation Bible School. Yay, and all the parents are happy. At least it's a week. It'll be 5 days. So we're doing it a little early this year because of summer school conflict and whatever. So it's going to be not tomorrow, but next Monday from 9 to 11 every morning. The theme is going to be on the power of Jesus. So I don't know. Some of you older folks may want to come. I don't know. But kids will have Bible stories. We'll have crafts. We'll have games. We'll have songs. We'll have a lot of fun. We always do. And then the Sunday following Bible school, we'll come up and we'll fill the rest of you in on what we've done that week. But there's a table in the foyer. Sarah will be out there. I'll be out there. We'd like to start getting kids registered for, is it tomorrow? No, it is a week from tomorrow. I think it's June 7th. Okay, everybody got that in their mind? Okay, we'd like for everybody to be able to come and participate. And I want to go ahead and give a thanks to all the teachers that will be here to help. So not tomorrow, but okay, thank you.
Thank you, Patty. Well, if you've not been joining us on Wednesday nights, I think you may be missing something. I think we've had some really good teachings here the last few weeks, and really excited. We're going to start a new program. It's called The Story. It's by Max Licato and Randy Fries. But it takes the Bible, and it's written in novel form in chronological order. And one of their quotes that said, it's not to replace the Bible, but it's to point you towards the Bible. But it's to make it easier to understand and engage you more to want to read the scripture more. But let me, if we can, let's share a video for that real quick.
This is my story.
But most of all, this is the greatest story ever told.
This is God's story.
The Bible is not 100 ancient, unrelated paintings, but a mural all knitted together to tell the story of God's great love for us and the extent to which He will go to get us back. Parents must be involved in. No, parents must run point on the spiritual development of their children.
The purpose of the story is to help us understand God's script. He has written a saga, a sweeping screenplay, and we all have a part in it.
All right, that's The Story. It starts this Wednesday, and one of the greatest things, and across the board from everybody we talked to, the biggest draw for this is we're all going to be on the same level from every age group, because they're going to be, the kids are going to be going through it, the teens are going to be going through it, and the adults all at the same time at their different levels. And the teen version is the same, it's the same story. They just added pictures and stuff to the book. So it's a great opportunity to read the story together at home, because you read it the chapter ahead of time, and we come in Wednesday, we watch a video as the authors break it down, and then we just discuss the video and the chapter. So you get to, it's a great engagement for your family at home. Like I said, parents, we must take point. We can't just take our kids to the church and expect them to get spirit-led for 4 hours a week. It's not going to work that way. We have to take point at home. So I challenge myself and my family and all of you to get in there with your family, read the chapters ahead of time, and you can no longer, you know, when you ask your kids or teens what they talked about Wednesday night, you already know. So now you've got a chance to engage with them and get into some discussion there. But please join us Wednesday nights with that. We'll give you a copy of the Bible, a copy of the study guide. That will be yours to take home and do your stuff at home. But we really encourage everybody to join us for that. Let's welcome Pastor Jerry.
Hey, Curtis. Thank you. Kids, you want me to dismiss them? You're dismissed, kids. Curtis is supposed to take care of all those preliminary things, but sometimes he forgets, like we all do. This is Memorial Day weekend, and again, how many of you people know that whenever taps are being played, that there are lyrics to taps? How many know that? One. Two. I knew it, but I didn't know what, I couldn't remember the words. So at the end of the service, we're going to be playing taps, and John Wayne's going to be here with us. At least in word. But now next Sunday, Jeremy is going to be ministering. I'm going to be out of town. We've got to go do a memorial service in Carthage, Missouri for a dear coach who died. He's a friend of ours on the river. And he coached a lot of teams, a lot of places. But he died suddenly of a heart attack a few months ago. So we're going to be going to go out there. And Jeremy's going to be filling in. Jeremy, you cannot... What Nina did, I'm telling you what, she did a great job. Didn't she do a good job on Mother's Day? But you're good, Jeremy, but she was just as good. So thank God for that. So we'll be back, though, next week, the following week, and continue on with this message of prayer. So I basically wanted to get back to basics, and I talked about getting into the Word of God, and I may have been misquoted or misunderstood, or maybe I misspoke. I don't know which I did, but anyhow, I said a couple of things that I shouldn't have said. Number one, don't throw away the King James Version. Don't throw it out the window. Keep it on your shelf so that you can prove to somebody that you read it one time. But get some other versions. I mean, be real, because it really will inform you and enlighten you. I said another thing, that the Bible is not the Word of God. Now, the Bible is the inspired Word of God and is profitable for doctrine, reproof, correction, and instruction in righteousness. It is the inspired Word of God. But if you just put this on the shelf and you never get it to open it up and you don't get the Word out of here into your heart, then it's just a bunch of stories. And it's prophecies and many other things. But quite frankly, what I was trying to say is you got to get the Word out of the Word. You got to get the rhema out of the logos into your heart so that you can do something with that. And so today, that's what I was trying to say. Do you, everybody understand that? Okay, so that was just getting back to basics. And that was getting back to basics of reading the Word, memorizing the Word, meditating upon it, and then praying the Word. So today I'd like to talk about praying the Word. Praying is a tool, or it's not a tool or an exercise to get everything you want. Most people think, well, I'm going to pray and I can get what I want, because the Bible says, ask and it shall be given, right? Knock and the door will be opened unto you. So, can't talk and drink at the same time, so. Most of the time, prayer is to get us in alignment to the will of God so that we can accomplish His purpose. Amen? But many times in the American church, you know, we want what we want, when we want it, and how we want it, and we know everything about what we want, and we just think, my name is Jimmy, gimme, gimme, gimme. And that's not what God is like, you know. So we use prayer, though, to accomplish this. I got a newsflash for you, okay? God wants our best more than we want our best. So you've got to recognize that God's plan for you is absolutely, it's desirable. And He wants to accomplish His plan, His purpose, and His will in every one of our lives. And so He wants it more than you want it. So the key is not to get God to do what we want done. It's really, prayer is the making of the adjustments in our lives to accomplish His divine purpose for which we exist. Amen? Let me just give you an example here. Joe's not here, I don't think, Joe Scobie. But Joe loves to whistle. And one day we were working, and he was just whistling up a storm, and sometimes it made sense, sometimes it didn't. I couldn't follow the songs all the time. And so I just had called a prayer meeting between me and God, and I said, God, You got to help him stop whistling. And he said, well, why do you want me to put a cork in his mouth? I said, I don't like it. I don't like his whistling. And he said, I do. So prayer is learning to like what God likes. It's learning to enjoy what God enjoys. So I had to make a choice, either quit working with him or just learn to like it. So I began to whistling, trying to get him off tune, and it became a game. You know, it was really fun to do. So anyhow, prayer is a heartfelt request of God. It can be a request, a petition. It can be intercession. It can also be supplications. And basically, supplication is just an earnest desire to see God do something in your life. And there's times that you need to do that. And prayer is really, someone asked me just the other day, is faith needed when we pray? I thought that was a dumb question. Now, the person's not here who asked me that. But if you were, I would still probably say the same thing. Why pray if you're not going to have faith? You know, so Mark 11:24, it says, whatever things you ask, when you pray, believe that you receive them and you will have them. Now, you can't get any clearer than that, so you've got to believe that you're going to receive. Amen? So many times, though, our faith is lacking. And 1 Thessalonians 3:5 says this, and we continue to pray to see your face, to see you face to face, and mend and make good whatever may be imperfect and lacking in your faith. So many times we pray and we don't have the faith for it. But we've got to have faith. We've got to expect God to do something whenever we ask Him. Amen? So this is why every one of us, when you pray, you've got to expect God to give an answer. I got an interesting story here in Acts chapter 12. Start reading with verse 1. This is the Passion Version, so just follow here with me. It says, during this period, King Herod incited persecution against the church, causing great harm to the believers. He even had the apostle James, John's brother, beheaded. And when Herod realized how much this pleased the Jewish leaders, he had Peter arrested and thrown into prison. During the Feast of Passover, 16 soldiers were assigned to guard him, and Herod could bring him to public trial immediately after the Passover. Celebrations were over. And so the church went, look at this. The church went into an intense intercession seeking God to free him. So the church were gathered together in one place, John Mark's mother's house and Mary's house, and they were just praying to see God release Peter from prison. You know, get him out of there. Now, the night before Herod planned to bring him to trial, he made sure that Peter was securely bound with two chains. 16 guys were guarding him. Peter was sound asleep between two soldiers with additional guards standing outside his cell door. When all of at once, an angel appeared to him, said, and he filled the cell with a brilliant light. And the angel struck Peter on the side to awaken him, and he said, hurry up, let's go. Instantly, the chains fell off his wrist, and the angel charged him, put on your sandals and get dressed and get your cloak and follow me. Peter quickly left the cell and followed the angel, and through, even though he thought it was a dream or a vision, for it seemed unreal. Absolutely. He couldn't believe it was really happening. They walked past, they walked unseen. This is interesting. Unseen past the first guard post and then the second before coming to the iron gate that led to the city, and the gate just swung open all by itself right in front of them. Is that not miraculous? I find that so interesting. They went out of the city and were walking down a narrow street when all of a sudden the angel just disappeared. That's when Peter realized that he wasn't having a dream. And so he said to himself, this is really happening. This is real. I'm out of prison. And so the Lord sent his angel to rescue me and from the clutches of Herod and what the Jewish leaders planned to do to me. When he had realized this, he decided to go to the home of Mary and her son, John Mark. The house was filled with people. They were praying. When he knocked on the door to the courtyard, a young servant girl named Rose got up to see who it was. And when she recognized Peter's voice, she was so excited that she forgot to open the door but ran back inside the house to announce, "Hey, Peter is standing outside." And they said, "Are you crazy? Why do you think we're here? He's in prison. We've got a prayer meeting going on, and you're thinking he's outside the door? What's wrong with this?" I wonder whose faith caused this to happen. I mean, this is so interesting. I just find it. He says, "Are you crazy?" they said to her. They kept insisting, "Well, it must be his angel. It's not him. He's in prison." Meanwhile, Peter was still outside knocking on the door when finally it opened. And they were shocked to find Peter was free. Now, sometimes the answer is standing right outside your door. And you keep on asking and you keep on asking. And sometimes you've got to open the door and receive your answer. As a matter of fact, remember the Walendas? I forgot the guy's first name. Who walked across the Grand Canyon. Now, Joel Osteen, I watched that. I was so amazed at that. Joel Osteen was there, and he led in prayer for safety. And so I'm sure that Mr. Walenda, he prayed before he walked. But that day it was just for a prayer with John Osteen. But whenever he got on the tightrope, on the tight wire, and he began to walk. You know what he said? He said, "Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. I can make this. I can do it." And he kept on thanking God and praising him and began praying the word, "I can do all things through Christ who strengthens." So while he was on with no, there wasn't any type of safety net down below, he was walking across this wire across the Grand Canyon. But again, he had prayed before. Joel Osteen prayed also with him, and he began to thank God for the answer, that "I'm going to make it safely. I'm going to be secure." And so this is just an example of how to pray. So this message is about prayer. Again, the difficulty of this subject is not to try to convince you that you need to pray. It's like exercise. We need to work out, and again, either to get in shape or stay in shape. You know, I worked out a couple of years ago with a guy, and he worked out every day religiously. I mean, he was there. And I said, "Why do you work out?" Now, the answer was so interesting. He says, "Because so I can eat anything I want and not gain weight." I thought, wow, I'd never even thought about that. I could eat anything I want and still gain weight. But he was praying. Again, he wasn't praying for results. But he says, I want to eat anything I want and not put on weight. I'd like to subtitle this message, "Praying for Results." Some people pray out of a habit. It's a good habit to get into. But have you ever I have prayed the Lord's Prayer so many times. You know, "Our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Kingdom of God come, will of God be done." This is so important. It's a good habit to get into. But you can get into a habit where you can also then, over time, it becomes a routine and you get into a rut. So this is why that praying in the Spirit is so important, that you've got to pray in tongues and let the Holy Spirit just illuminate your life and your prayer time. But we must get the Word out of the Bible into our hearts and our minds to make application and then pray the Word. If you want to be powerful in your praying and praying for results, you've got to pray the Word. And again, because how did the devil, whenever the devil was tempting Jesus, you know, how he said, it is written. Every time he come across the Satan's temptation, he said three times, it is written. Man shall not live by bread alone. It is written, you shall not tempt the Lord your God. So he was praying the word to overcome the temptation. But others, though, they pray only when emergencies hit. I mean, it's a 911 call. Illnesses, accidents, mishaps, misfortune, potholes, and again, detours that come to our lives. We all only pray then. Most people only pray whenever they have an emergency. In praying for results, the Lord's Prayer is a good one. It's positive, it's proactive, and it's productive. And James says the effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. So if you want things to happen in your life and be productive and to be proactive, you've got to pray like the Lord. And the disciples came to Jesus and they said, teach us how to pray. And he says, well, our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Holy is your name. Your name will be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. And you got to just go through those names of Jesus. And whenever you do that, you recognize, hallowed be. Man, your name will be called Wonderful. His name is such a wonderment to all of us. Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father. This morning I was just coming in, I said, Abba, Father. I love to call you Abba, Father. Dear Father. And thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Now this is what I'm doing today is I'm giving you daily bread. Now this is weekly bread that I give, but you need to be into the word every day getting daily bread, because he said man should not live by bread alone, but by what? Every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God, which was written down for us. But you've got to get this written word out of the Bible into your heart so that you can pray effectively. Amen? Now, prayer is good whenever we do spiritual warfare. You've got to and really, you can't do spiritual warfare without praying the word. 2 Corinthians 10, 3 through 5 says, the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they're mighty through God, mighty in God, for the pulling down of strongholds, casting down vain imagination and every high thing that would exalt itself against the knowledge of God, bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. Now, strongholds are really, how does the devil develop a stronghold in your life? First of all, he gets a foothold. He gets a little bit of something against you, and he'll get this foothold, and he'll keep bringing it back to your mind. This is why you've got to cast down vain imaginations and every high thing that would exalt itself against the knowledge of God, bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. Now, then there's another passage in Ephesians 6:13. He says, put on the whole armor of God. Now, I'm going to address myself today from the top down. Putting on the helmet of what? And the breastplate of what? And your loins are girded about with, and your feet is shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. And then he says, above all, take the what? So the shield of faith. So sometimes our faith is lacking, or it's been somehow demolished, or somehow something's happened to our faith. And so Paul says he'd come to the Thessalonians, he's coming back to help them establish and get their faith growing again. So above all, taking the shield of faith, and then verse 18, it says, praying always, say always with me, always with all prayer and supplication, how? In the Spirit. This is why when you're driving down the road, or you're coming to work, you're going to school, you know, you can pray in the Spirit, in tongues. Pray in tongues. Because this is really how you really build up your most holy faith, by what? Praying in the Holy Ghost. That's how we do it. So putting it simply, prayer is just simply talking to God, the creator of the universe, the ruler of all things, and not only that, but he's the one who controls the times and the seasons, and he raises up leaders and he disposes of them. So we got to recognize that our confidence is not in the Republican Party. It's not in the Democratic Party for sure. It's in the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords who rules everything. And in his time and season, he'll take down the ones he don't want in there. But folks, we've got to pray, though, for those in authority over us. It's very important that we do that. Amen? And again, I was praying that a certain president would be removed. Now, I didn't pray, no, not anything to do, not dying or anything. I hope he doesn't die. But I hope he gets out of office. But you know what? I was praying with a selfish motivation. And so it's really not. And so God, I said, listen, it's up to you. If you want him out, you'll take him out. Because you're the one who raises up rulers and you dispose of those rulers that you don't want. So now strongholds, let's go back to that just for a second. There are rational strongholds and then there are irrational strongholds. Irrational strongholds, they don't make any sense at all. It's like our government. It doesn't make any sense to me that we would destroy the pipeline that makes us energy independent, and then we destroy that, and then we become energy dependent. Is that not nuts, or is it just me thinking? It's crazy. Thank you, Lynn. That's a good God word right there. But strongholds, irrational strongholds, are not the hardest to deal with. The rational strongholds, because they make sense to us. And so out of the greatest, I guess one of the greatest tensions of the Bible is the pragmatic versus the miracles. An example, there's no logic or pragmatism about spending money on expensive oil to anoint the feet, the head of Jesus just before his crucifixion. Yet his disciples, they said, now this is logical, but this is a stronghold. We need to sell that oil and take the money and give to the poor. And Jesus said, let this lady alone because she is anointing me for burial. So this was why, and again, it seems like it would be a logical thing, so just let her alone. What's practical about throwing a stick into where an axe head flew off the handle, throwing a stick into the water and the axe head coming up to float? Nothing practical about that. What is practical about having a lady who just had a little oil left and Elijah said, go borrow all the vessels you possibly can. What is logical about getting as many vessels whenever you don't, and they're empty vessels, and pouring the oil that you have into the one vessel that you do have and filling all those others? That's a miracle. That's God's working in their life. Just be aware that sometimes ideas that seem logical can be a stronghold that prevents the kingdom of God from being established in your life. And this is how prayer is a weapon against every enemy of our soul. Let's look and see how prayer is proactive and productive. Now this is really Ephesians 1, 16 through 19. It says, I do not cease to give thanks for you, remembering you in my prayers. Now this is not a prayer against the enemy. It's a request for something from God. In praying that the Lord Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you, look at this, number one, the spirit of wisdom. The spirit of wisdom, something that's very proactive. That's the intuitiveness, the instinctive ability to know what to do, when to do it, and how to do it. And the Bible says, if any man lacks wisdom, let him ask of God who gives to all men liberally. He wants you to have wisdom. Wisdom, the Bible says, is the principal thing. With all of your getting, get wisdom. And not only that, but understanding. Wisdom says, I am understanding. If you get wisdom, you're going to have understanding. You're going to understand the times and the seasons. And the revelation of the knowledge of him would be having the eyes of our heart enlightened so that we may know, cause us to know the hope to which he has called us. Now that hope is that expectation of good to happen. Jeremiah 29:11. God says, I know the plans I have for you. They are good and not evil. They are to give you a future and to give you a hope, or to give you the future you hope for. But if you're not hoping for something positive and you got this expectation of something bad happening, guess what? That expectation of bad is fear. And fear will cause you to tremble. And fear will cause you, and this is why so many times it says, be not afraid, do not be afraid, do not fear, do not be discouraged. I am with you. I will deliver you. Many times in the Word of God, it says all that. But to hope means to anticipate with pleasure and confidence. And then he also prayed that we may know the riches of his glory, of the inheritance in the saints. That's us. God's glorious inheritance is in us. So we got to recognize it's a good opinion of yourself and other people. That's that glorious. It's the absolute perfection of God's will in our lives. I didn't give you this, but Psalm 62:5, it says, my hope and my expectations are from him, are the outcomes that I desire. In other words, God, whatever your expectation is for me, that's my expectation for myself. And whatever your expectation is for other people, that's my expectation for them. So our expectations are the same as God's, or should be in our lives, and because God says, I know the thoughts that are planned for you. They're good, not evil. Give you a future and a hope. So, now the fourth petition of Paul's prayer in that Ephesians 1 is dynamite, that we may know what is the exceeding immeasurable greatness of his power, or his dynamite, his ability toward us who believe. To those who believe, all things are possible, or all things are doable to those people who believe. Amen? It's accomplished by the power of God in us through his word, by praying the word. Remember, the word of God is sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even the dividing asunder of the soul and spirit, the joint and the marrows, and is a discerner of the thought and the intents of the heart. Now, I'm going to get on a couple of areas here of what prayer does that, and I'll close. Productive praying, and to me, this happened a couple of years ago. It was a revelation to me. And it's not anything big or great, but it's really powerful, though. Hebrews 13, 18 and 19, it says that Paul, now I believe Paul wrote Hebrews. Now some people don't believe that, but that's, you can believe what you want. But pray for us. We are confident that we have a good conscience in all things, desiring to live honorably. But especially I urge you to do this, what's this? Pray that I may be restored to you the sooner. Pray that things will be expedited and situations and circumstances that surround my life from coming to you as well as later or on time, it could be expedited. I urge you that I would pray for us that I'd be restored to you the sooner. Now, this is where it really gets interesting. This is now, and again, if you don't believe this, that's up to you, but I believe that prayer actually accelerates God's purpose and plans in the earth concerning us. I think that many people, they miss God's plan and his purpose in their lives because they have not prayed and they don't believe that God has the ability to expedite and to speed up things in our life. I believe that he does. There are other things that are natural. For an example, you know, I remember a couple of things about whenever I was a kid. I was always fascinated with my brother's shaving, and I was wondering why I didn't have to. And I couldn't wait until I got a chance to put the white stuff on there and just shave it off. But there's time. I mean, all of that is a process. You grow into certain things. You grow into. You know. And again, I remember my mother telling me a story when I was 5 years old that I'd hurt myself, and Mom said, come on, Jerry, get up. Now, this is her telling, you'll be well before you get married twice. I said, well, when am I ever going to get married? I hadn't even been married once in 5 years old. You just got to be old enough to get married, amen? The process of being restored can be accelerated or sped up. Is that the word? Speed it up? Sped? Is sped a word? Okay, sped up. That it would be sooner rather than later. Now, I want you to notice something. If this were true in the physical restoration, what about the financial restoration and the restoration of relationships and the healing of our bodies being sped up? I think that that can take place if we begin to believe this. And Paul would say, I just want to be restored to you the sooner and not later. And I want it now. And you do too. Surely you do. So, another place in Ephesians 5:16, it says one can actually buy time with prayer. He says, make the most of the time by buying up each opportunity that presents itself to you, because the days are evil. Now, congregation, you all know the days that we are living in, they are evil because lawlessness is abounding. And whenever that happens, the love of many people will grow cold. But, I mean, whenever you're wanting to defund the police, I mean, come on. How idiotic can you believe that and still breathe? I mean, you just can't hardly do that. Why would you want to do away with law enforcement or military? It's crazy. But so evil is looming, and we can postpone, though, the influence in our lives by prayer. So when good is delayed, we can actually accelerate its coming to us when we pray. And that's why we pray, kingdom of God come, will of God be done. But let me give you an off-the-chart example in the Old Testament of how time itself can be subjected to our prayers. How time itself. Joshua chapter 10, Joshua was facing five Amorite kings, and God promised him the victory, and the battle was ongoing, and the time was quickly fading away. And in verse 12, Joshua spoke to the Lord. That's what just communicating with God, that's prayer. Spoke to the Lord, and he said in the sight of all Israel, sun, stand still over Gibeon, and moon, stand still in the valley of Ajalon. He's talking to these natural elements. So the sun stood still and the moon stopped. The result, Joshua bought some time through prayer and he was able to defeat the Amorites. It did not accelerate the time through prayer, but it bought some time and it delayed the time for about the space of 24 hours. All because he spoke to the Lord. Now this is why I'm saying, time can be sped up, accelerated, or it can be slowed down and delayed. Whenever good is taking place in our lives, we need to enjoy that and bask in the goodness all the days of our life. Amen? All because of prayer. Now, this is another interesting story in Mark chapter 6. Verses 44 through 49. And that one is really, they just fed the 5,000, 15,000 people probably all together. And Jesus told the disciples, get in the boat and go over to Bethsaida. And he went up to a mountain to pray. So while he was up there on the mountain, and these guys had already departed, and I would be guessing it's probably 6 or 7 whenever they left, and they were going across the lake, which is about 8 miles wide, 13 miles long. They were going across, and they got into the middle of the lake. Now, this is amazing to me. A couple of things. Number one is that Jesus was able to see them 4 miles away. Now, I don't believe, I think that he maybe saw that in his spirit, and he saw them rowing and trying to, because the wind was against them. And so they were really just trying to make this happen. And the Bible says that Jesus would have passed them by. Just because you've got an emergency doesn't mean that God's going to answer that. But whenever you have an emergency and you think that your life is about over and your destiny is about completed, you got to recognize something. If you see Jesus walking on the water, which they did, they thought it was a ghost, and they cried out. And Jesus said, fear not, guys, it's me. It's I am is here. But would have passed them by, but they cried out. There's a crying out in every one of our hearts. God, I need you in this situation. I need you in my business. I need you in my marriage. I need you with raising kids. I need help in school. I need help. And folks, I think if I'd prayed more in school, I'd made better grades. But I did graduate in the top 1% of the bottom half. Now, Jesus, while they were 4 miles out, about halfway across, on the fourth watch of the night, about 3 o'clock in the morning, probably, he saw them and he went walking to them. I don't know how long it takes Jesus to walk 4 miles, but on water it may take a while. But nonetheless, I don't think, he just tiptoed right out there. It could have been trans something. But have you been struggling with a situation or a condition in your life and you just really, you thought, man, I'm exhausted. I don't think I'm going to get out of this thing unless Jesus shows up. Well, whenever Jesus showed up, he got into their boat. Now, this same story, keep in mind everything that just happened now, would have passed them by. The same story is recorded in John 6, 21. And the Bible says in John 6, 21, they willingly received him into the boat, and look at this, and immediately the boat was at land where they were going. Now, the key word there is immediately, because in the actual geography of that, they were about 4 miles from land. But it said that because they cried out, Jesus came and got in their boat, and they were immediately at the other side. Crying out to God can help accelerate and speed up answers in our life. And answers will be accelerated and solutions will appear in the now if we will just allow that and recognize that sometimes our answers are knocking on the door. Jesus said in one place, and referring to another point in time, he said, before they call, I will answer. Wouldn't it be wonderful if you got that? If we prayed about everything, we prayed about our destination, we prayed about our marriages, we prayed about our family, we prayed about kingdom of God coming to our kids, and I'd still do that with my kids and grandkids. Kingdom of God come, will of God be done. That's really a declaration and an affirmation of faith that's being done. It's not a begging or requesting. You know, you affirm that, and you confess that. And this in your life, I mean, I was out here the other day just in my own life. Kingdom of God come, will of God be done. I want your will every day of my life. And I want you to arrange my destiny. I want you to arrange my meetings with people so that I've got divine encounters that's coming down the pike every day. And you all, and I pray the same thing for you all. Because you know what? These divine encounters, whenever they come, they've got a purpose behind them. And you've got to recognize that. Better not tell that story. If I get into this other one, I'm not going to have time to finish it. So I'm just going to close up right now. But how many people recognize that prayer can actually accelerate answers to your life? Okay, it can happen. And how many times, whenever good is present and you're winning some battles, God can also extend the time and allow time to stand still for a while. And whenever you're in trouble and you're in a boat and you're beginning to wonder, God, is this boat going to float anymore or are we taking on water? The interesting, another time that Jesus was in the boat, he was sound asleep and the storm came up and he was just riding it out. I mean, there was waves that were just putting him to sleep. And the disciples, Master, don't you even care that we're about to perish? Yes, he does. He knows where you are. He knows your address. If he knows the hairs on your head, I'm telling you, he knows everything about you. And he knows what's going on in your life. And he wants you to just recognize him that he's there. Give God applause for that. Man, hallelujah. Now, I don't know what needs you're facing, but if you have needs, we're going to believe with you. Let me just put it this way. If you need God to speed up something in your life, stand over here to my right, your left. If you have something good's taking place in your life, I want you to come up here. We're just going to agree with you. Stand to my left and your right. If you want something good's happening, you want to just bask in that. So if there's anybody that wants to do that, just come right now, quickly. Right over here, if you want it to be sped up, over here to be slowed down. Wow, we got a lot of people wanting things. Hey, speeding up is a good thing, amen? Come to you the sooner. Amen. James and Shirley, I know exactly what you guys are believing for. I'm working on it. I know. I'll come over here to you guys in just a minute. But right now I want to deal with, you know, they're not all the same situations. Some of you've got financial situations, some you've got marital situations, some you've got just relational health. Health is one of those things that God wants to restore to you the sooner. You know, He is restoring my knee, but boy, it's not as fast as I want. So I said, God, please hurry up the healing here. So every one of us, though, would you just stretch your hands forward? What are you here for, Mike? Oh, you're in the left hand. Well, move over a little bit. Oh, you're both. Okay. Oh, okay. Well, just stretch your hands forward right now. Father, for all those that needed an acceleration of an answer, or Lord, they're needing something sped up in their life, in Jesus' name, I am in agreement with every one of them. I bless them right now with an expedited solution for their lives. Be it health or healing, be it financials, God, or be it whatever for James and Shirley. Situations to be arranged so that, Lord, this will happen in due time. Not only in due time, but in expedited time. So, Father, I'm thanking you right now that for that taking place in their lives. Lord, for this couple over here, these people over here that needed things just to slow down a little bit, Lord, I pray right now for a victory that they may be facing, a battle where that they need some more time to accomplish this project and to accomplish their destiny. I am in agreement right now with every one of them that, God, your time is right now being slowed down so that they will be able to accomplish what you want done in their life. In Jesus' name. You all agree with that? Hallelujah. Father, we thank you. Now, everybody, would you all stand across the auditorium here? Stretch your hand toward me and agree with the prayer that I'm going to pray for myself. Okay? That healing would take place sooner rather than later. Amen. I believe that by His stripes, we are healed. Amen? We can receive that. So every one of us, I want you to know, God is wanting to expedite some things in your life, and He's wanting Him to slow down some things in other people's lives. That goodness, surely goodness and mercy will overtake me. And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. You got to recognize goodness and mercy is chasing you down. He's wanting you to just respond and receive goodness and mercy to your life. Begin to confess that. Begin to recognize it is God who wants to work good things in my life. Amen. Father, we rejoice in your goodness. We rejoice in your love. Hallelujah. Amen and amen. Is there anything else? Anybody's got something else you want to pray about that I hadn't covered? God hears our prayers. But now listen very carefully. And I close with this. Second closing. God loves it whenever you make time for Him. Early in the morning with a cup of coffee, right over here is where I love to just meet Him. It's the quiet time. It's with Him in His pavilion. And He speaks to me. I had a situation this past week. I said, God, I need wisdom. Because we were about to get some things hooked up wrong, James and Shirley, over at your place. I need wisdom. Folks, I prayed. I prayed here for about 30 minutes to get the mind of Christ on this. And whenever I got over there, what I wanted to do, the guy that was doing it, he said, I think we ought to do it the way, and it was the very same way that I wanted. I said, man, I'm in agreement with that. And I didn't have to do a lot. Just seek God. But He's wanting to have you to have... He says, if you will just come in and shut the door, your closet, go to your prayer closet, shut the door, spend time with Him every morning. And again, pray the Word of God over your life. All things are good in God. And the devil, he's out to steal, to kill, and destroy your life. So, Curtis, where are you? He's working in your life, isn't it? Yes. Beautiful. Amen. Thank you. Beautiful, beautiful. Congregation, as your pastor, I just want to do what you want to do about the vaccination. But as your pastor, me and my family, we're not taking it. So you all, be sure you read up on it before you, if you take the vaccine, excuse me just a minute, be sure you read up on it and do your research on it before you take it. But I just think it's something that's not good. And so I want to pass it on to you, every one of you, that my recommendation would be that you not take it. And again, I'm not trying to be political here or any way, shape, or form. I'm just trying, I want to keep you healthy, okay? Keep every one of you healthy. Curtis.
Praise God. You may be seated. What a good word, Pastor. Thank you for sharing. There's a quote, you know, just really got to me this morning. I've seen it before, but it said, only two defining forces have ever offered their life for you. One was Jesus Christ, one's the American soldier. Man. Praise God. One died for our salvation, and they both died for our freedom. Thank you, Lord. Well, Pastor had found this video. We want to watch it now to remember our veterans.
It was July in Virginia. The scent of the dogwood and the laurel lay heavy on the land, while the burgeoning fruit of the peach and the apple marked the full sway of summer. For seven fateful days, the trees, the flowers, yes, the very ground itself, had shuddered under the roar of cannon, the bark of howitzers, and the crackling of a legion of rifles. Now all was silent. Sledgehammer blows of Robert E. Lee and Stonewall Jackson had mauled the Army of the Potomac, and yet that army was not destroyed. 7,000 men had fallen in that dreadful week, and the savagery of the conflict was grimly evident in the river of wounded that wound through the green hills. Now a new sound drifted in the soft evening sky. For Colonel Dan Butterfield, a courageous and able soldier, was also a man of music. To honor his fallen comrades, he had composed a simple and heart-rending melody. On July 2nd, in the year of 1862, its strains floated over the graves that scarred the dark Virginia earth. It has been more than 100 years since that sound was born, but those notes have never died away. Every night of the year, throughout the world, fighting men of America from the north and the south, the east and the west, close their eyes in sleep to its call. And in each of their hearts, there glows a fierce surge of pride.
I was one of the many that did not realize. Yes, go ahead. That there was lyrics to the taps. Pastor said, look them up. He told me that this week, so I did. So I'd like to share those with you. They should have done a few of them there, but it says, day is done, gone the sun. From the lake, from the hills, from the sky, all is well. Safely rest, God is nigh. Fading light dims the sight, and a star gems the sky. Gleaming bright from afar, drawing night, falls the night. Thanks and praise for our days, neath the sun, neath the stars, neath the sky. As we go, this we know, God is nigh. Sun has set, shadows came. Time has fled, scouts must go to their beds. Always true to the promise that they made. While the light fades from sight and the stars gleaming ray softly send to thy hands we our souls, Lord, commend. That has always been a powerful thing just to hear that playing, but to know what the words behind it are now, I think it's just that much more. Lord, we thank you for this day. We thank you for those who gave their life for us. We thank you for your son, Jesus, who gave his life for us. And we give you praise and we give you glory. Be with us all as we go out. In Jesus' name, amen, amen.